Jim said, I'll be talking to you today about Ebola virus. And Ebola virus is the virus that's really responsible for hemorrhagic disease. And it really made a big name for itself a couple of years ago when it caused a large-scale outbreak in West Africa. And so it was chilling images like this of the Ebola healthcare workers bringing in a child in late-stage Ebola disease that really brought home that this virus can cause really severe disease. And not only does it rob us of our health and our lives, but it can also temporarily rob us of our humanity. But our story with Ebola really begins back in 1976 in a small village called Yambuku, which is in what is now the Democratic Republic of Congo, but was formerly called Zaire. And so what had happened was a headmaster for the mission school had gone up further north into Zaire, and he bought some smoked monkey meat and antelope meat. And he came back to the village and started coming down with really horrible symptoms, so a lot of fever, chills, vomiting, diarrhea, things like this. And so initially, the symptoms of Ebola are a little bit nonspecific, and so they can be easily confused with some other diseases, such as malaria, typhoid, or yellow fever, which are caused by parasites here, so plasmodium falciparum for malaria, bacteria, salmonella for typhoid, and yellow fever virus to cause yellow fever. And these were diseases that were much more common in the area. So when this headmaster came down with these symptoms, and they thought initially maybe it was something like this. But what we now know is that a lot of, what he most likely experienced was something a lot more severe than what you would ever experience with those kinds of diseases. So again, he started off feeling joint pain, some sore throat, fever, headache, but then it started progressing into the vomiting, diarrhea, eventually having some hemorrhaging symptoms where you can, where some of your organs will start to sort of start leaking and breaking down, and then ultimately he ended up dying from the disease. So what happened is that, so after he came down with the disease, there was actually quite a large scale or an outbreak within that village, and ultimately there was about 318 people that were infected, and then about 280 people died. And so this gave us a case fatality rate of about 88%. And so a lot of the people that came down with this infection were treated at the Yambuku Mission Hospital, which is just shown right here. And so this was run by a group of nurses, And one of their standard practices was that any time somebody came in with some sort of a fever or an illness, they would then give these people just injections of nutrients and anti-malarial drugs. But unfortunately, they only washed them with water in between each injection. So unwittingly, these poor nuns really probably contributed to the spread of the virus throughout this population. But so about halfway through the epidemic, where they had, they were really very clear that it wasn't malaria, it wasn't typhoid, and it wasn't yellow fever, they had sent these samples up to Europe to try and identify what is actually causing these people to become sick. And so they started to isolate or tried to hunt for a new virus. And so the way that we do this is something called serial pathogen. And so for, and in this particular instance, what they did is that they took the blood from a person with the disease, and then you presume that there is some sort of virus that's actually inside of it, and then you put it onto some human cells to try and sort of propagate the virus to help it grow out a little bit more. And so you put it on the cells here, then you actually look, because this virus can then cause some cell death. And so you look for cytopathic effect, what we call CPE. And so then you're looking for a virus that's kind of replicating out here. And then you take that and you put it onto new cells to try and isolate the virus this way. This is called serial pathogen. And so what the scientists had eventually been isolated was this virus up here. This is just a microscope image of what we now consider as the classic Ebola virus image. And what they had noticed is that it looked really, really similar to another virus called Marburg virus, which had just been isolated maybe a decade before. So they weren't sure if it was really Marburg virus or if it was something different. And then to actually try and figure out whether or not virus or Marburg, they took antibodies from somebody who survived the disease. And so once you actually get infected, you survive, you actually have an immune response, you develop antibodies against against this disease. And so if it recognizes either one of these viruses, it means that your body has actually seen one of these two things. And so they were able to take the antibodies from somebody that actually was one of the few people that survived the disease, and then they tried to bind it either to this new virus here or to Marburg virus. And then what they were able to find is that the antibodies recognized this virus, but when they tried to get it to recognize Marburg virus, it didn't recognize it at all. So this really suggested that this was a new, something new that the world hadn't seen before. And so they wanted to, so kind of what to call this new virus. And typically when scientists discover a new virus, they normally name it after the town or the region where the virus was first identified. But because of the severity of this disease, they really didn't want to introduce stigma into the people of the Yanbu village. So what they did is they decided to name it after a river. And one of the rivers that's close by is the Ebola River here, which is actually just a little offshoot of the Congo River. And so it's actually, it's called the Black River, and it sort of snakes through the countryside and through the rainforest. So it seemed like a very appropriate name for this virus. And so since then, we have discovered a number of other viruses that are all related to Ebola virus. And so they now fall into a family of viruses called the filoviruses. And so filo is derived from the Latin term for thread, which really describes the shape of the virus. And so we have Marburg virus and Ebola virus, which are the two viruses that they initially tried to decide between. And so now within Ebola virus, we know that there are five other viruses that all can cause, that are all sort of related but cause slightly different disease. So we have Zaire, which is the original one that was isolated, Sudan, Bundibugyo, Thai forest, and Reston. And so as you can see here, all of these are all Ebola viruses here, and these are the ones that are really associated with human disease. And so we have a little color coded here, so this is a map of Africa, and each one of these little circles represents the number of cases for a given outbreak for Ebola. And so we have, so red is Zaire, the green is Sudan, Côte d'Ivoire, which is also called Thai Forest, just had an instance where it affected one person in 1994, and then Bundibugyo here caused an outbreak in 2007. So one thing that I think you can probably appreciate is that a majority of the outbreaks are all associated with Ebola Zaire. And of course, this is exactly the virus that was the one that was responsible for this last outbreak here. And so in 2013, there was a large-scale outbreak of Ebola in West Africa, and it primarily affected these three countries, so Guinea, Sierra Leone, as well as Liberia. And even though the epidemic started in 2013, you can see that a bulk of the cases, and so this is the number of cases here, and these are all the individual colors represent the different countries, and so the more you have, then the more cases that you have. And here we have 2014, 2015, and into 2016. And you can see that a bulk of the cases actually came about in about towards the latter half of 2014 and into the beginning of 2015 here. And so this was really when the world started to panic that this was kind of getting out of control. This was larger than we had ever experienced before. And so when it was all said and done, there was over 28,000 people confirmed infected with Ebola, potentially more if you don't have people that were never actually officially diagnosed. And that resulted in about a little over 11,000 deaths. And so this puts that case fatality rate at about 40%, which was certainly lower than the original outbreak, which was 88%, but it's still quite scary that you could have this level of death caused by a single virus. And so how does something like this even start? And so both Ebola and Marburg virus are considered zoonotic viruses, and that means that they can replicate in both humans as well as in animals. And so there's been a lot of discussion about whether or not Ebola actually can live in bats. We know that Marburg for sure lives in bats, and this is really how it's transmitted in the bats don't get sick, so they seem to live with Marburg just fine. We think that's probably the case with Ebola as well. But what likely happens is that when you have an infected bat, it then comes into contact with different animals, such as gorillas, antelope, or chimpanzees, and then these animals then become sick with Ebola. So they don't show the same symptoms as humans, but they also become relatively sick. And so some of these animals, they may die, and then some of them are hunted by humans for bushmeat. And so in an instance that we call a spillover event, where a human would come in contact with an infected animal, become infected themselves, and then go, and then once they become infected, they can then pass on to other humans. And so we now know that this occurs pretty fast, and this is how we get this really explosive epidemic. And so there are three main ways that we know Ebola can spread quickly between people. So one is, sort of the funeral practice that was very common in Africa, where when somebody dies, the family and friends and family come and bathe and touch the body. But of course, if this person has died from Ebola, there's a lot of virus, and then this is a lot of time to tell these people that become infected and then go on in that way. Another way is through people being sick, going to see a doctor or a healthcare worker. They're having those non-specific symptoms where they don't know it's Ebola, they think maybe it's malaria, maybe it's typhoid, and so then the healthcare worker doesn't fully protect themselves and they become infected, and then when they're seeing other patients, they can infect others. And then another way is through just the care, and when somebody is sick, that you want to actually touch them and help care for them. But unfortunately with Ebola, it's such a contagious disease that this is really where it can spread as well. And so this was sort of the spillover event here is the kind of the critical event that actually leads to a large-scale outbreak. And so in this last epidemic, we know that it was really started by a single spillover event in Guinea, which is right here. This is Guinea, but it starts right here. And so what scientists have been able to do is to actually be able to map the water, map the different viruses throughout the epidemic to kind of identify, recreate the spread of Ebola. And so one thing that I do want to point out, repeat the video here, but I don't know if you noticed, but there's a couple of hot spots there where it just seemed like the virus sort of exploded, and this was like individual cases. And so it was really, so here's where it starts and it goes, and you can see it's just spreading to different areas. And then here, this is really where it starts to explode. And then this was where the entire international community got very scared, because these are international places where you have people coming and going from various areas. And of course, we did get a handful of cases that came into the US and into Europe. But fortunately, those were very limited and they didn't cause large-scale outbreaks here. But this is something that now we're aware of. This actually happened just from a single spillover event, so just one contact with an infected animal. Okay, so it's all can be very scary, but scientists are really trying to work hard to figure out ways that we can combat Ebola. And the two main areas that we can use science to help combat Ebola is through the development of vaccines and therapeutics. And to do this, we really have to have a solid understanding of how Ebola causes disease. So, like I said, there were outbreaks, but there were actually relatively limited numbers of people, and so they were in remote areas, so scientists couldn't really understand. But once the virus had been identified, scientists could actually start to study it. And so how we do that is in these high containment facilities, and these are called Biosafety Level 4 facilities, or BSL-4. And so there are 11 BSL-4 facilities in the United States and Canada, so there's one right up here. And then what scientists have to do is they wear these sort of space suits that that protect them completely from the outside air. They even have their air piped into them from the outside, so they can safely work with the virus in fire safety cabinets here. So these are all designed to basically keep the virus inside and protect the workers. So it's really through the hard work and dedication of a lot of these scientists here who've been working in these ESL4 facilities that we really have started to understand how this virus replicates, how it causes disease, and then helps us figure out how we can actually combat it. So this is, I'll do a little bit of immunology here. What normally happens when we encounter a pathogen, such as the malaria, typhoid, or yellow fever, is that we have a group of cells called innate immune cells, and these are really acting as the sentinels of the immune system. So they're out in the body, they're patrolling, and they're really looking for these pathogens here. And so once they encounter one, after it's infected your body, these sentinels then send out signals, and they call in the cavalry, which are these other innate immune cells, including more of themselves here. And these all come in, they infiltrate into the site of an infection, and then they help basically kill the pathogen. So at the same time, these sentinel cells are also signaling to other cells called T and B cells. And so these are cells that then help lead to antibody production, which is the one of the parts of your immune system that really helps fight viruses and bacteria, as well as these things called killer T cells that can identify all these infected cells and then get rid of them. And so together, this group of these cells really leads to clearance of infection, so you can go on to survive and go on and live. So, but in the case of Ebola, Ebola actually targets these sentinel cells. And so instead of the cells being able to just recognize them and then send out the alerts, Ebola disables these cells a little bit to allow itself to replicate more and more. And then once it's reached a certain amount of time, then the cavalry does eventually come. But of course, because it's bringing in some of the cells that Ebola likes to infect, it infects those cells as well. And so then it's reaching, it's replicating more and more, you get more virus. And then at one point, then all these cells, they're trying to clear the virus, but there's just so much of it that you have something called immune pathology, so they're overactivated, and they are just trying to kill, and then you end up damaging a lot of healthy areas. And so at the same time, through mechanisms that we don't fully understand, Ebola also causes the T cells to start dying. So that means that you don't get as much antibodies, and you don't get as many killer T cells to help combat the virus. And so this together will then lead to the severe disease and the death that can experience. And so so the virus is made up of a number of different proteins. And I'm not going to go into too much detail here, just to say that each one of these proteins is vitally important to the virus. And so what we know is that you can generally categorize them into three groups. So this group of proteins here is involved with viral replication, so it allows the virus to make more of itself. We know that these two proteins here are the ones that are really responsible for disabling those sentinel cells that allow the cells to initially start to replicate. And then finally, we know that this protein here, the glycoprotein, and this is the protein that covers the whole surface of this virus here, and this is really the protein that mediates infection. So it's the protein that the virus needs to get into your original cell, or to the original cell, and then just kind of kickstart the whole process. And so while scientists have tried to target each one of these different proteins in order to disable the virus, really the one that has been the most effective and the one that vaccines and therapeutics have really focused on has been on the glycoprotein here. And so I'll talk a bit more about the vaccines and therapeutics here, but just to kind of clarify, a vaccine is given before you ever encounter a pathogen, and it really helps train your immune system to recognize and stop infection. And so here, if you have a vaccinated person, and then they come in contact with Ebola, their immune system will hopefully recognize it immediately before it has a chance to actually infect, and then you are protected from disease. So therapeutics then work after somebody has been exposed. exposed or infected. And it's something that helps them fight the infection to help cure the virus and then help them survive. And so the way that we test vaccine efficacy is that we use an animal model. And so so we know that Ebola infects monkeys, and so the one that closely mimics human disease is this model that we use called cynomolgus macaques. And so antibodies are really one of the main ways that vaccines can protect, and so when you vaccinate a monkey or a human, what you end up having is you have an increase in antibody titer. So we have, so the higher it goes up here, then the more antibodies that you have. And especially in this case, it's the more antibodies that you have that are specific for the virus. And then over here on the x-axis, this is time here. And so we see that, so by day zero, this animal here doesn't really have any antibodies, but then it starts to increase probably by about day seven. It starts increasing through day 14 until you hit day 28 here. And then you see that your antibody titer sort of plateau here, and so they then remain steady for a while. And so this is actually a time that we call peak immunogenicity. And so this is when your antibody titers are at their highest. And so oftentimes, when we're testing vaccine efficacy, this is the time that we want to challenge with the Ebola virus and to see whether or not this level of antibodies is sufficient to protect the animal. Okay, and so the vaccine that is looking the most promising at the moment is something called vesicular stomatitis virus, and it's actually a virus itself. And so it's a little bullet-shaped virus here. It causes disease in livestock, so cattle and horse. But what's kind of interesting, or it's just what's good about it, is that most people do not have immunity against VSV, which means that as a vaccine, it's good because you can inject somebody with it and they won't reject it automatically. So because people don't have immunity, it means that there really hasn't been much infection in humans. And so infections in humans are rare, and when it does happen, it's asymptomatic, which means people don't have any. And what's especially nice about this particular virus is that it's glycoprotein, so this is the part of that virus that mediates cell entry, can be swapped out for any other viral glycoprotein. And so here, this is just a brief schematic of the genome of the virus, and this is the G protein here, so the glycoprotein. And so what they've done to make this vaccine is they've taken out the VSV glycoprotein and they put in the Ebola glycoprotein. And so then you have a virus that sort of still looks like VSV, but it's actually now got the Ebola glycoprotein on the surface. So then it looks like Ebola without actually being Ebola. Okay. And so when they took this vaccine and then they vaccinated monkeys and then they challenged them during that peak immunogenicity that I talked about. And so here then we're just looking at survival. And so this is, so 100% means that all of the animals survived this lethal challenge. And so if you see a horizontal line, it means that all of the animals survived. So however, if you see that it kind of drops down like this to going to zero, it means that all the animals died over a certain amount of time. And this is the time, days post-infection. And so when this vaccine, or when these animals were vaccinated, and then challenged with Ebola, we see that all the vaccinated animals all survive, whereas the ones that were not vaccinated all died. And what's important is that this vaccine, you know, these animals are still alive almost a year later, so it wasn't like it just temporarily blocked the infection, and it really did protect them completely. And so with this, so this vaccine, like, nobody had really seen something like this before. We have 100% of the animals protected. You can even dose down really low. They're all still protected. And so the next question was, how quickly can you be protected? Like, do you need to be in this peak immunogenicity phase in order to have this vaccine work? And so then they asked, okay, so this is sort of our reference point here, where you've got peak immunogenicity, all the animals survive. What if you then track back a little bit? Can you immunize and then be challenged at day 21, where you're not quite there, but you've got a lot? Here, day 14, where you're still starting to ramp up, day 7, where you really don't have much antibodies, and then even 3 days post-infection, where there's no antibodies, you really shouldn't have. Your immune system is just suddenly just starting to see the glycoprotein, how well can this vaccine work? And this was all happening during the time of the epidemic, and so this was really kind of pushing us because people were very, needed something to help stop it. And so again, we're looking at a survival curve here. So the horizontal line would be all of the animals survive, whereas anything going down means that the animals die. And then what you can see here is that if you vaccinate at day 28, 21, 14, or day 7, pretty much you have all of the animals survive, which is incredible from a vaccine standpoint here. And then even if you vaccinate at just 3 days before you challenge, you still have 60% of the animals surviving, which means that there is something happening with this vaccine really early that is helping protect. And so this is very, very exciting because now it means that you don't have to wait a month in order to be vaccinated and then be in an area with Ebola. Okay. And so with all of this data, this is where scientists really started to move quickly through clinical trials. And so clinical trials they normally take a really long time, so about 10 years or so. And it's really to try and evaluate the real safety and efficacy in humans before you start getting into the general public. So again, this normally takes years, except for this particular one, this was very expedited, which is really unique for clinical trials. And so they're divided into three phases. So phase 1, 2, and 3. And so phase 1 is generally called safety and immunogenicity in volunteers. So it's really only with about 30 to 100 people. And they're really asking just only three questions. So one, does the vaccine cause an adverse reaction? Because you really don't want to introduce something that would cause much more disease. So ESV, like I said, does cause can infect humans, but it doesn't cause disease. So we're really wanting to make sure that this vaccine The second question was, really we need to understand if humans actually have the same antibody response as the monkeys. So we knew that the monkeys would be protected, but if humans weren't going to induce the same responses, then it wasn't going to work. And then finally, what was the best dose? Because there was a range of doses. Sometimes for these trials, they can really put a lot in there to protect these animals, but when it's realistically in a human, you need to kind of figure that out. And so this is the phase 1. And so this was actually conducted in two different sites, both in the US and Europe, and this happened by about 10 years, which is, again, it normally takes 3 or 4 years. So phase 2 is the safety and efficacy in the target population. And so phase 1 is done in US and Europe, so these aren't places that really have Ebola. So what phase 2 meant was that they were then going to go to the target population where Ebola was happening. And so this was in Liberia. So the questions that they're still asking are, does this vaccine cause adverse reactions? And now they can start to ask, does this vaccine actually work? And so finally, the phase 3 is also in the target population, but now instead of going from 100 to 500 people, now they're looking at 300 to 3,000 people. And so this was a trial that was conducted in Guinea in 2015. And here they're still asking, does this vaccine cause adverse reactions? Because now that you're vaccinating thousands of people, you're more likely to actually see whether or not there is something that you didn't see in a much smaller population. And they're also asking here, does this vaccine work? And so the phase 3 trial that they conducted was something called a ring vaccination. This was also a very unique type of strategy for clinical trials. And here's the breakdown of how it works. So when they were actually testing this, it was actually in the kind of the waning days of the Ebola epidemic. So there wasn't a ton of infections happening. But what they were able to do is they were able to identify people that did get infected. And then because of the human-to-human transmission of Ebola, you can identify the people that this infected person came into contact with. And this is what was called a primary exposure. And then you have another ring out here of people that came into contact with this person, so you have a secondary exposure here. And so they had identified these rings of people who were around an infected person. And so then they had two different, what they call arms of the trial, which means that half, so they had all these different rings, and then half of the rings were selected for immediate vaccination, which means as soon as they came into contact with somebody with Ebola, they vaccinated them. And the other half, they delayed the vaccination by about 21 days. So that meant that if somebody came into contact with Ebola, and then did get infected, that would be enough time for the virus to actually show itself. And so what they found that was in the group that had the immediate vaccination, there were no cases of Ebola. Whereas in the arm with the delayed vaccination, there were 16 cases. So these are small numbers, but it does mean that we have 100% vaccine efficacy for this trial, which was, again, pretty phenomenal. And so the other, I'll talk a little bit more about this later, because this is now being used as a strategy to help limit outbreaks in the future. But now going back to the other aspect, which was the therapeutics. So just to remind you, the therapeutics are given after somebody has been exposed or infected. And so this is, I won't go into too much detail here, but this is sort of how the virus actually gets into your cells. So here it is, and then this is where it uses a glycoprotein to get in, and it goes through its whole replication cycle here, and eventually goes out and makes more of itself out here. And so there are two groups of therapeutics. So one are called immunotherapies, and these try and use the immune system to block and clear infection, and here we're using antibodies. And there was one particular cocktail of antibodies called ZMAP, which I'll talk a little bit about in the next slide. But the immunotherapies target is they target this first entry step here, so they try and block the infection from starting at all. And so the other group of therapeutics is called small molecule inhibitors. And so these are molecules that directly interfere with the ability of the virus to replicate itself. And so they target more of this later stage here. And so there are two in particular, favipiravir, which acts here where you prevent basically the virus from making more of its own protein, and then one called TKM Ebola, which kind of blocked the later stage here, so blocked the virus from actually making it, releasing out into the outside the cell. And so we test therapies the same way that we test vaccines, only this time instead of a vaccination, we're actually just infecting with Ebola virus here. And so now, instead of having antibodies, we actually have Ebola virus in the blood. And so what does happen within this this monkey model is actually it happens relatively quickly, where almost by day 2, and certainly by day 5 and day 7, you just have this escalating amount of virus coming up. And so it's really a challenge, actually, for these therapeutics to try and save these animals from a disease where it's fatal. And so the idea here is then to administer the therapeutic at different days, and so we can administer it day 2, so right after, so like before the virus is really taken off, day 5, where it's starting to get pretty bad, and then day 7 as well, where you're pretty close to getting it there. And so one of the therapeutics was a ZMAP, so it's called under that immunotherapies group. And it is a cocktail that's made out of three different antibodies. And the way that they produce this is actually kind of interesting. It's because they use plants to produce these antibodies. So it's very defined, and it makes huge quantities, which is great. And so then you have these three different antibodies, and they all bind to the glycoprotein of this virus. They all help block that entry into your cells. And so now we're looking again at that percent survival, where the horizontal line means that everybody survived, and if you go down, it means that the animals did not. And so what they did is that they gave ZMAP either 3 days, 4 days, or 5 days after infection. And so by 5 days, these animals are starting to show pretty severe signs of disease. What we can see is that once they administered ZMAP, these animals actually came back and they were cleared and they went on to survive. So that was incredibly promising. That now, even if you have somebody that's been infected from Ebola, you could give them something like ZMAP and then help them overcome and survive. So unfortunately, when they also did clinical trials for these therapeutics. So there was one controlled trial of ZMAP that was conducted during the last part of the epidemic. And so one of the major conclusions was it said the estimated effect of ZMapp would appear beneficial. It didn't meet its statistical threshold for efficacy, so it really wasn't. They're not moving that one forward just yet. And so there was also trials conducted for those other two therapeutics that I talked about, favipiravir. And so the results from that, they said it was nuanced conclusions about efficacy, which was more or less that it didn't have any efficacy at all. And then TKM Ebola, which was the one that targeted that last stage, there was no efficacy reported. So there's still work to be done for the therapeutics. I myself am trying to make a better version of ZMapp, so hopefully that can be something that we can use in the future. So this epidemic was the largest that we've ever had. So there's actually quite a lot of things that scientists have been able to learn from this. And so one of the biggest things, and one of the main questions that we've been asking from the very beginning, was how do you distinguish a fatal from a non-fatal infection? And so one thing that we now know is that looking at, because now we have many different patients of different ages, and we have a lot more tracking of knowing their virus loads and things like that. We now know that if you're 45 or older, you have a much higher case fatality rate than if you are below 21 years old. So the older you are, the higher your case fatality rate may be. And then also, when we look at viral load, I mean, this may also, as you can see from the animal, you can just see it escalating here. But now we know that the more virus you have, the more likely, the higher your case fatality rate. And then finally, we also start knowing that there are some symptoms that are more associated with a fatal outcome rather than not. And this is something that was sort of not really appreciated, or we couldn't really tell before. And so certain symptoms, such as, so it's hard to see, but weakness, dizziness, diarrhea, abdominal pain, these are much more associated with a fatal outcome compared to just simply headache or fever. So it now gives healthcare workers something to sort of identify. Like if a patient is suddenly having dizziness, then they know that we really need to help this person now. And so this, I think, would be very, very useful. Was useful during the epidemic, and then for future outbreaks as well. And so another thing that we learned was that the virus can actually adapt as well. And so this was a large outbreak that occurred over a number of years. And so what ended up happening was that there was normally just a single, so there was a single spillover event, so it was probably caused by a single virus. But during the course of when it was going through different people, a new mutation arose in the virus and then became much more dominant. And so you can see here, this is just we call it genotype A versus B. And so you can see genotype A, it just starts off in early 2014, and it's really the only virus that's around there. And so the second mutation starts popping up by July in 2014, and it's about equal with the A genotype here. But then, later in the epidemic, you see this B really takes over. So there was something about this change that really made the virus potentially more able to spread between people. And so what it turns out that this mutation does is that it makes the virus able to infect those sentinel cells that I told you about earlier, and allows it to infect them better than the A genotype. And so this is what we call increased infectivity. So this has probably contributed in some way to the spread of this virus, and made it so much worse than what we've seen before. And so finally, the biggest thing that we have learned now is that surviving Ebola is really not the end of the journey, unfortunately. So we now know, because we have thousands of survivors, that virus can actually persist within people for at least a year, and we'll probably keep monitoring these people out much longer. And so we know that it can go into the brain, into the eye, as well as into the testes here. And so one of the more striking things is this infection in the eye. And so this is actually the same person. This was a doctor who survived Ebola. And so his eyes are normally blue, but about about a year after he recovered, he started having some eye pain. And then what was happening, he started losing vision, and then, I don't know how well it comes out here, but you can see that this eye is now changed color, and it's actually green. And so they were able to identify that there was Ebola in his eye there, and so it was actually still lasting within him for a while. And so in addition to having this virus still staying in these, these sites, we now know that survivors also seem to have long-term health consequences. And so many of them experience problems with vision, which may be related to having some residual Ebola in their eye. Many of them suffer from arthritis, so they have a lot of joint pain. And then a subset of them also have hearing problems. And so I think as we even go further away from the epidemic, we may learn more and more of how all the long-term consequences of Ebola. And for me, I think this is actually one of the largest challenges that we have to face. And we really have no idea how to help these people and how to help them move past Ebola to really rebuild their lives. Okay, and so of course now we're in 2018, so the other epidemic ended in 2016, but we just had another outbreak, so this time it was back in the Democratic Republic of Congo, so in the DRC, so this is where the original epidemic all started here in 1976. And so this is the currently affected area, which is kind of in the eastern part, or no, sorry, the western part of DRC. So it's not as large as the previous outbreak, but it's actually, it seems to be contained at this point. And so what they have done is that the health workers have come in and they have vaccinated everybody using that same ring vaccination strategy that I told you about that they did in their clinical trial. And that really seems to have limited the spread of the virus, and actually I think now the outbreak is declared over, so it's a slight success story for what we have. Okay. So I hope I've been able to show you today that scientists have been working to study all aspects of disease, and this has really been critical in trying to combat Ebola, and that vaccines against Ebola are promising so far, and there are hopefully on the way. And importantly, that infectious diseases can really emerge with both local and global consequences. So this is one reason why we're always, it's good to even look beyond our borders, right? You know, and just kind of pay attention to all the different diseases that are happening in other countries outside of our own as well, just because they can, in today's travel, they can easily emerge from, a small place in Guinea all the way over to the U.S.
So the people that are living with Ebola now in their body, are they worried about they
have infections again? Yes and no. Yeah, so it actually, so we do know that there are, I mean, some people that have it, along for quite a while. So it turns out, at least with the eye, it seems like it's not so infectious. Like it stays within the eye. It's not like the tears are not infectious on the outside of the eye. There's no virus. However, in terms for infection in the testes, we do know that there have been a couple of cases of transmission. So these people are still being actively monitored, I guess. But yeah, there is always a worry, and we can't really access the brain, so we have no idea. There might be other places in the body this virus is still happening as well. So it used to think it was just if you cleared it, you survived. Somebody has been, so they had confirmed that these people were infected. and so then the vaccination is not so effective after somebody's been infected. But it's more effective if they've been exposed before somebody's been exposed, or if they've had contact but maybe not become infected. So they were vaccinating, yeah, these people are out here, and then these people. Vaccination strategy right now, especially with this last epidemic, where it worked, it seems to have worked relatively well in containing it. I think they're using it as a response, and then potentially that's just vaccinating areas that are more likely to have it. It's not feasible to have, like, say, everybody in the U.S. vaccinated against it, but maybe certain areas of DRC would be so
effective. Given all the organs and systems that are affected in the persistent virus, is there any thought that the infection may go beyond just the immune system?
Oh yeah, no, absolutely it does. Yeah. So the first, I apologize, that I should have gone into more detail, but the initial cells that it infects are those immune cells, and eventually it starts to infect pretty much everything. And so what's kind of interesting about those particular sites where virus seems to persist is they're called immune privileged sites. And so these are sites where you really don't want a ton of immune cells going in there, so the brain, because they can cause a lot of damage, as well as the eye. And so there's not much trafficking of these immune cells in there. So how Ebola actually gets in, or what it's actually replicated in, is really an open question. I really don't know. We can try and do sort of models with cells from the eye, and you can see it replicating in there, but whether or not is that how it got there, is it going on all the time, or this doctor, he was fine for about a year and then it just so yeah, what exactly is triggering this? It's still something that we're trying to explore.
What is it that the mechanism that this virus does to human cells that it doesn't do to bats? I'm sure if you knew this, it would be problem, but
this is a great question. This is something that we can't study with Ebola just yet because we don't actually even have proof that it's in bats, but we can study it with Marburg. And it just seems that probably what has happened is that these viruses have co-evolved with bats, and somehow the bat copies them. We don't really know. And there's a couple of scientists that are studying, but they're actually trying to study Marburg in bats and trying to figure out what's the transmission, like how many bats are on this, but it's not so easy to maintain a bat colony, especially in a PSL4 setting. These questions are really, I wish I had an answer for you, but it's something that's really of interest.
It does seem like the virus that just immediately kills everything it affects is not very successful.
Yes, no, actually, that's a really great point. And one of the things is a virus really needs a host cell to replicate, right? And so if it kills its host, it's not a great virus at all because it needs it, it really hasn't adapted. So this is where I think the co-evolution of the virus with the bats has allowed sort of for a coexistence that, you know, we have viruses in us as well that don't cause us any harm, but they might be very detrimental to others. This tobacco plant that actually seems like a really nice way to make a lot of antibody.
Does anyone have any other questions about what it's like to be a scientist? About how you become a scientist?
About Ebola?
About it anyway. Okay. Thank you, Bonnie, for an awesome talk. So next week, we're going to switch gears for the first time ever and do a non-like health science stuff. We're going to talk about renewable energy. So we're letting out one of our engineers. We usually keep them in the cages in the back room. But, let them out. Just right here. And then there's a couple weeks off, and the next topic is GMOs after that, and then ultimately vaccines. So if this talk got you really excited about vaccines, come back for that one. I'm theoretically giving that one. My wife is doing it 6 days after that talk, so if it comes early, it might be someone else, but there will be a talk about vaccines, I promise. So, awesome. Thank you guys for coming. Enjoy the snacks and drinks and stuff. If you have any comments or anything, suggestions, questions, write them down on the question card. We want to make this better all the time. So, thanks for coming. So where's the BLS from right here?
Oh, sorry, yeah, it's at Boston University.
Yeah,
it's called